I've joined the fire service in November 2000 and I'm currently employed by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in Edinburgh. I've been aware of the problems with the official story for 9/11 since approximately it was 2010. For a period of time, I was in a state of shock that we had not been told the truth about that event. I was surprised that I hadn't seen Building 7 before. It's not something that's been publicised. There are not many people that know about it. If you want to know about Building 7, you more or less have to go on the internet and research it for yourself.
My name is Michelle Weiss-Little, sister of fallen hero, FDNY, firefighter David Martin Weiss.
Yeah, I'm born for firefighting. Ever since I was a kid, you know, I know what I wanted to do.
David was a firefighter, and firefighters risk their lives every day for their brothers and sisters. For you, and for any of your family members, my brother would have gone into that building no matter who was in there, no matter who is responsible. He faced his fear and he did his duty. As a country, we promised we would never forget. They gave their life. At the very least, we can give our time to demand a real investigation.
Thank you everybody for coming, and we really appreciate the courage you have to show up and the openness you have to listen to what we have to say tonight. And I'm just going to start by telling a little bit about my story and how I came to change my views on this completely. Right after 9/11, I tried everything I could to get out to Ground Zero. I was on a team that we thought they were going to call up, but they didn't, and they ended up calling up a USAR team instead. Anyways, I went out there for the funerals. I helped support however I could. This was there about a month and a half after Ground Zero. And so I was very emotionally attached to it. When anyone would talk about it, I couldn't listen. I just didn't want to hear it. I didn't want to consider it. And my lieutenant for years had told me that it looked like, you know, something didn't add up. And I just told him he was crazy. He should leave the country. I was very patriotic, and I just thought, if you believe that anyone could be responsible for this, you shouldn't be here. It was a friend of mine from the military that actually opened my eyes to something else. And one thing led to another, and I kept looking. 9/11 kept coming up. And because it wasn't being shoved down my throat, I decided to look into it a little bit more. And when I did, I knew there was a lot of conspiracy theories out there and a lot of crazy conspiracy theories, and I decided to do my own research. And so I went to the Zacharias Moussaoui exhibit trials. This is the U.S. government's evidence on 9/11, basically. And I wanted to see what they had. I was kind of shocked. I wanted to know, how did they identify the terrorists so quickly? You know, how were they so sure? And so as I started looking, this is what I found. And this is the main evidence that they had. This was found after the plane crash. This was found the next day. So you can see they found bandanas, papers, more passports. You can see these passports. They're pretty well intact. I've been to a lot of fires. And if they're out in a room that's not on fire, we'll find this kind of stuff. But the thing that stuck out to me, and someone else had pointed out, was, well, wait a second. Those passports, those IDs, they were inside either pockets or luggage or inside that plane. Then that plane hit those towers or went into the field or went into the Pentagon, and then they blew up. There were big fireballs we all saw. And then they were found actually on top of the pile. So that stuff started not adding up for me. I was like, well, wait a second. How'd they find it the next day? It should have been either on the ground or burned up or buried in the rubble. That led to Colonel Nelson. Once I started looking into this, I read his article, and he's a 34-year Air Force crash investigator, and he'd written a pretty amazing article, and he talks about his own experience into 9/11. And once I spoke with him, I asked him, I said, when did you first notice something was wrong? He said, for me, it was the first day. And I said, really? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, what stuck out to you? He said, well, I've been to a lot of crash sites. I know how they work. And he said, it was the Pentagon. And he said, when I looked at the Pentagon, and here's some pictures of it, he said, what I saw the first day was people picking up debris, and they were removing it as quickly as possible. He said, every crash I've ever been to, it's the MP's job to secure that area, flag it, tag it, take pictures. Nobody touches anything until after the investigators are there. Well, they were cleaning it up before any investigation. He said by day three, he knew something was wrong. And by day three, is when he said they identified the terrorists, and it was the IDs. He said, there's no way. He said, find those 19 terrorists. It would have taken weeks to months to find that kind of evidence, to sort through it, to go through it. And he said, they recreated the aircraft crash. He said it was impossible.
9/11 was the greatest loss of life and property damage in U.S. fire history. This should have been the most protected, preserved, over-tested, and thorough investigation of a crime scene in world history. Sadly, it was not. What was it? Well, we know from their own admission, the majority of the evidence was destroyed. I, like Richard said, 22 years of experience, I've seen a lot of crime scenes, I've never seen anything like this in my life. I was out at the site, I saw trucks leaving faster than, you know, anywhere I've ever seen, but I accepted it at the time, and for years I accepted it, because it was a recovery and rescue operation, and that's normal to have something like that going. Again, we never seen anything like it, but that was expected. What I didn't know for years, what was going on behind the scenes, was that evidence was being destroyed when it was shipped off.
On the day of 9/11, while the remains of the Twin Towers and World Trade Center 7 were still smoldering, one of Mayor Giuliani's first concerns was clearing away the evidence from the crime scene.
We were able to move 120 dump trucks out of the city last night, which will give you a sense of the work that was done overnight.
It's wild out here. They just keep coming. Look. It doesn't stop. There's more. I keep thinking it's at the end, and it's not.
Despite reassurances that the rapid removal of the evidence from Ground Zero was important for emergency access, this process went far beyond merely clearing a path for rescue workers. As Eric Lawyer, founder of Firefighters for 9/11 Truth, points out, the massive operation to haul away over 1.5 million tons of debris and to sell much of the steel to Chinese firm Bao Steel at discount prices was not just an overzealous approach to clearing the area, but was itself a crime.
By their own admission, this investigation of Tower 7 had no physical evidence. How do you investigate a crime when you've destroyed all the evidence? It doesn't make sense. They also admit that they refused to test the explosives, or to test for explosives or residue of thermite.
Did you do any explosive residue testing on any item out of the building just to lay these ideas to rest?
Answer to that is no. We did not do it.
Now, this is what I'm going to go into here just real quickly, is there are national standards for an investigation. That's what all of us are asking for, an investigation that follows national standards and holds people accountable. This manual right here, just so you can see it, is what we'd call the kind of the Fire Investigation 101. This is the most basic fire investigation manual there. This is for the 2001 edition. This is what should have been referred to, at least. It doesn't have to be followed exactly, but it should have been used as a guideline for the investigation. I'm just going to cover a few of the things that are in here. So NIST violated, and the initial investigators that did not protect the scene violated, the most basic of the guidelines. And I'm going to cover five of them here. One is the NFPA 9.3.6. It covers spoliation of evidence. What it reads is, once evidence has been removed from the scene, it should be maintained and not destroyed or altered until the investigation is complete. The steel was melted down prior to the investigation. We know that from their own admission. This is no conspiracy theory stuff. 19.2.4, exotic accelerants. If on the scene you find melted steel or concrete, you should consider the use of exotic accelerants. And they specifically say in the manual, thermite mixtures produce exceedingly hot fires that can account for melted steel and concrete. That also says they leave residues that can be tested for visually and chemically identifiable.
FEMA described samples of steel that had been thinned to razor sharpness. In some cases, there were inexplicable holes in the steel. The fire engineering professors who found the samples could not come up with an explanation for it. They also could not explain the sulfidation of the steel. That is, steel had been chemically changed at the microstructural level in ways that indicated a chemical eutectic mixture had been achieved between sulfur, iron, and oxygen, causing steel to melt.
Again, they did not test for it. And just put it in perspective, on a routine house fire, if we suspect even the slightest use of an accelerant, we're going to test for it when there's no fatalities, when there's very little property damage. So to not do it on this, there is absolutely no excuse. I can't drive that point home enough. 18.15 is analyze fuel source. All available fuel sources should be considered and eliminated until one fuel can be identified as meeting all the physical damage criteria. For example, if you find pulverized concrete, which we all know there was in all three buildings, there was pulverized concrete. the only fuels that can create seeded explosions should be considered. So they shouldn't be considering fires. They shouldn't be doing that. It doesn't account for pulverized concrete. They should only be considering exotic accelerants and explosives. 19.4.8.2.6, extremism. The terrorist may include fire as but one of a variety of weapons along with explosives used in furthering his or her goal. We know they used them in 93. Why would we not test for them now? There was reports that day, multiple reports, which I'll get into here in a second. So they could have put them in the basement. How do we know that unless we test for it? I mean, even if it is the terrorist that they claim they are, we need to test this.
We did not find any evidence that explosives were used in the collapse of Building 7. We ran down detailed computer simulations of blast scenarios. This size blast would have produced an incredibly loud sound that was not recorded on videos of the collapse nor reported by witnesses.
You want to call your mother or something?
We made it at least two blocks, and we started running. Floor by floor, it started popping out.
It was like, it was if if they had detonated.
Detonated.
If they were planned to take down a building. Boom, 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 boom.
What happened?
It was an explosion. It was in the lobby, and the third explosion, the whole lobby collapsed on us.
What was it like? What was it like?
Horrible.
It's like hell. You don't want to know.
The whole building just collapsed on us inside the lobby.
Is that a secondary explosion?
Yes, it was.
That was the
planet problem?
Yeah, definitely secondary explosion. Because we was inside waiting to go upstairs. And on the way upstairs, the whole fucking plane blew. And we just collapsed on everybody inside the lobby.
Similar to the first tower coming down, secondary?
I don't know about the first one, but I know the second one, it was terrible. Then there was a third one, too, after that one.
Third explosion after that?
Yes, sir. Everybody was inside the building waiting to go upstairs. And they just let loose. Everything just let loose inside the building.
So what you told me is that there was plane or whatever hit the building, then a secondary explosion.
It was like three explosions after that. We came in after the fire. We came when the fire was going on already. We was in the staging area inside the building.
14.3, preservation of the fire scene and physical evidence. We find the following. The cause of a fire explosion is not known until near the end of the investigation. The entire fire scene should be considered physical evidence and should be protected and preserved. It's just over and over. There's so many. You can go to our website, the Firefighters from Island of Truth. We have many more of these actual chapters that cover what they should have done that they did not do. So now by their own admission, in all three building collapses, NIST refused to physically test, like Dr. Stephen Jones did, for explosives. This is just unbelievable. And here are their excuses, and I quote, "It is unlikely that 100 pounds of thermite or more could have been carried into World Trade Center 7 and placed around columns without being detected, either prior to September 11th or during that day." So again, I've been on a lot of fire scenes, and I've seen a lot of investigations, and why would we not test because something's hard to do? That's the exact reason you need to investigate it. If that was hard to do, we need to find out how they did it. And number two, NIST excuse. In addition, no blast sounds were heard on the audio tracks of the video recordings during the collapse of World Trade Center 7 or reported by witnesses. That's one of the excuses why they didn't test. Well, apparently they didn't read Chapter 18. 18 is the general definition of explosions. Although an explosion is almost always accompanied by the production of a loud noise, the noise itself is not, in big bold letters, an essential element in the definition of an explosion. The generation and violent escape of gases are the primary criteria of an explosion. So that alone says they should have tested for it. But then we also, the NIST has lied, and we can prove it. As soon as the new investigation happens, the evidence is out there for you to see right now. We have 118 first responders who reported explosions. We have the radio transmissions from FDNY members that are still recorded today that reported explosions. We have audio recordings. We have video recordings. I've personally talked to witnesses that heard them. So there's nothing short of saying they lied, and they need to be held accountable. And besides that, like I said, there is no excuse for not testing for explosives. And so at the very least, at the very best, even if you want to believe the official story, this was the most incompetent investigation of all time. And I've talked to a lot of investigators that were there, and I asked them the specific question, why did they refuse to test? They weren't the ones who refused, but NIST did. And they said, all we can say, all they can answer is incompetence, or they tell me to shut up. They cannot give me any reason that follows national standards. So, but the reality, after, all the research everybody here and the incredible people we're in the room with today have done, the reality is it was a criminal investigation to cover up the crime. So I'd like, just to finish, I'd like to read a quote. This is from a retired decorated FDNY lieutenant. Anyone who knows the fire service, he is a stud. He worked on Ladder Company 26, Rescue Company 3, Rescue Company 1 in his career. Anyone who knows, those are amazing companies. Here's his comment. Trade Tower 7 by itself is the smoking gun. Not hit by an aircraft with only a few relatively small fires, it came down in a classic crimp and implosion, something only very precise demolitions can accomplish, which takes days, if not weeks, to prepare. The 9/11 Commission didn't even mention it, and FEMA actually stated they didn't know why it collapsed and left at that. Brothers, I know that the above implications are hard, almost unthinkable, but the official explanation is utter nonsense, and 343 of our murdered brothers are crying out for justice. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.